chemical, which has been always a challenge for the laboratories. Okay? Although many new technologies have been developed with better insight into the pathogenesis that is mentioned, but you start with the definition, and then the physiology, then it will come to be better in the interventions to prevent the hypertension. There is not a single uniformly accepted definition of economic hypertension. During the past two decades, more than two dozen definitions have been used by different investigators and the guidelines. And most of these definitions include three components. That was the measure of the intradialytic blood pressure behavior, intradialytic blood pressure decline, absolute or relative, and or occurrence of lower blood pressure during RSA and or lower specific spectrum. And secondly, intradialytic symptoms, which are related to the hypertension, like abdominal discomfort, nausea, vomiting, dizziness, fainting, restlessness, anxiety, yawning, or sighing, and finally, the requirement of the intervention to prevent the hypertension. Two more popular definitions, one was the PADOPI guidelines, 2005. They said decreasing systolic blood pressure by 20 millimeters or more, or decrease in mean arterial pressure more than 10 millimeters of mercury with symptoms. And the European respiratory guidelines in 2007 have the same numbers and presence of symptoms, but they added the requirement of interventions. Lately, in 2014 and 2005, these investigators emphasized more on the blood pressure numbers with the assumption that while analyzing the retrospective data, the information about the symptoms and the intervention is more often absent or not available. So they talk about the systolic blood pressure of more than 30 to a level of less than 90, and the other definition was systolic blood pressure fall equal to or more than 35 during RSA or any intradialytic systolic blood pressure less than 90 millimeters of mercury. They ignore the symptoms and interventions. In the pathophysiology, the multifactor, large number of complex interrelated factors play a role in causing the intradialytic hypertension. But most important is the decrease in plasma volume resulting from high interpretation when the compensatory responses are inadequate, and these compensatory responses are the cardiovascular responses, neurohumoral responses, and the plasma reflux. Blood pressure, as we know, is the function of cardiac output and peripheral resistance, and the cardiac output is again the function of the stroke volume and the heart rate. And there is decrease in plasma volume, there is decreased venous return, and this decreased blood volume made in the right atrium and the pulmonary artery is sensed by the baroreceptors there. And if there is more severe loss, then the volume is also sensed by the receptors present in the aortic arch and the aortic parties here, and they become deactivated. That result in release of tonic inhibition of the sympathetic outflow, resulting in stimulation of the vasomotor center, more sympathetic flow, and resulting in increased plasma norepinephrine, activation of the renin angiotensin endothelial system, increased secretion of the vasopressin, and then the secretion of the adrenaline. All these vasopressor hormones lead to vasoconstriction, increasing the peripheral resistance. The constriction of these resistant vessels also pushes the blood present in the capacitance vessel and resulting in the improvement in the venous return and cardiac filling. And that cardiac and this is also facilitated by these hormones, which are inotropic and gonotropic, that lead to increase in force of contraction and decrease cardiac output. So the cardiac output will be increased, peripheral resistance will be increased, blood pressure will improve. If these compensating mechanisms do not work or inadequate to make balance the loss of plasma volume, the patient will develop hypotension. Now, this is a normally when there is increased blood flow through the resistance vessels, these capacitance vessels, they stretch and there is pooling of the blood into the capillaries, leading to compromised pH return here. And when there is increased resistance, or constriction of these resistance vessels and blood flow decreases, then this is the elastic decoil of the capillary wall pushes the blood downstream, leading to increase in renal signal. And this is known as the jagged growth phenomenon. The redistribution of the regional circulation, core distribution, core regions, circulations are important in that sense. So planting is the most important, and then the kidney circulation. And in most severe body patient, kidney and muscle circulation are very important. All this blood can gain in this renal circulation as of the V1 receptors in here and increasing vasopressin, and second of the planting vasculature, pushing the blood back to the heart. More central circulation increasing the venous return. Transcapillary shift, and there is loss of volume, decrease in hydrostatic pressure in the capillaries, that stimulates the shift of interstitial fluid into the vascular space and into the plasma volume. One most important phenomenon here, it is called gyrus reflex. When there is increased sympathetic activity, vigorous contraction of the left ventricle here and the rapid rate there leads to stimulation of the mechanoreceptors present in the left ventricle, and those activation of those mechanoreceptors reflexly inhibit the vasomotor center and also stimulate the parasympathetic activity. That leads to decreased sympathetic activity, increased parasympathetic activity, peripheral vasodilation, that will lead to decreased peripheral resistance, and also because of increased parasympathetic activity, bradycardia. This is sort of a protective phenomenon. By causing the bradycardia, the heart will have more time for the filling and may improve the stroke volume. And this phenomenon is important to recognize because some of the medicines, the vasopressin medicines like fluoridine, diazem, or propranolol, which are otherwise contraindicated or not advised in hypertension, may be helpful in this situation by causing bradycardia along with more cardiac filling and improving the stroke volume. Treatment usual, tenable patients use to the ultrafiltration rate or stop ultrafiltration. Infuse doses of 100 ml normal saline. Infusion of salt or human immune, although it has been shown that no advantage over the saline and more costly. And then the hypertonic solutions, 20% dextrose, saline 2.5 to 10%, or mannitol 2.5%. If you are using those hypertonic solutions, it is important that these solutions must be administered more rapidly. This is the study done by Zimuzu, shows that when this 2.5 molar saline, 20 ml, was administered in 2 minutes, this was the effect on the serum osmolarity. This was the plasma vasopressin increase, plasma volume, and the effect on the blood pressure. As compared to when the same amount of 2.5 molar solution saline was given over 5 minutes, the increase in serum osmolarity was much less as compared to here in rapid infusion. Similarly, the increase in arginine vasopressin was less here, and And during hypotension, obviously, oxygen may be required to maintain the endorphin function, or direct acting as pathogenic receptor. Gels could be used, norepinephrine, epinephrine, or indirectly acting symptomatic, sympathomimetic drugs like amphetamine, or finally, if the blood pressure doesn't improve, you might have to stop the dialysis. While you are taking care of the acute episode, then you must be looking for some other more serious causes like sepsis, hemorrhagic pericardial effusion, worsening of the cardiac arteries, MIS, chest pain, bleeding, malignant damages, metaphasia, air embolism, dialysis reaction, or medicine overdose. Those can also lead to hypotension. You must look for those also. What do you do to improve or prevent these? First thing is, as I mentioned, the most important factor is the ultrafiltration rate leading to hypovolemia here. To reduce the ultrafiltration rate, increase peripheral resistance, optimize cardiac output, and improve the plasma leakage. To decrease the ultrafiltration rate, higher ultrafiltration rate is when there is more intradialytic weight gain. If you could control the intradialytic weight gain, then you will be able to decrease the ultrafiltration rate. And to limit the intradialytic weight gain, most important is the dietary counseling. Sodium restricted motivational use may be needed, sodium restricted diet, avoid hypertonic dialysis, reassessment of the diabetes. The erroneous assessment of the diet may lead to increased ultrafiltration rate. Most of our patients are diabetic, so control of diabetes, control of blood flow is very important. Then maximize diet use if the patient has residual kidney function. That will help to reduce the intradialytic weight gain and help to reduce the ultrafiltration rate. Increase the frequency or increase the duration of dialysis if the cost and the resources allow you. For the assessment of diabetes, in addition to the clinical examination, many of those other helpful removals, the gadget may be helpful, blood volume monitoring, ultrasound assessment of the inferior cava, then measurement of these BNP, N-terminal probe, BNP, retinal peptide level, ultrasound of the lung for the watery disease, and then biofeedback patterns. Use of diabetics. As shown by Siebel, two groups were compared. One who had to fulfill their predictions of loop diabetics, and the other one who did not. So they showed that those who have fulfilled the predictions of loop diabetics, they have lower intradialytic weight gain and lower incidence of intradialytic hypertension. Optimize ultrafiltration. So during ultrafiltration, make sure that the patient doesn't develop severe hypovolemia, which leads to hypertension. Different maneuvers have been tried, the ultrafiltration profiling, sodium profiling, combined ultrafiltration sodium, hypertonic, hypernatremic dialysis, isolated ultrafiltration or sequential dialysis, blood volume monitoring, biofeedback technologies, and then hemodialysis or hemodiafiltration or hemofiltration. Different types of liver profiling. This is the linear, higher ultrafiltration at the beginning and gradually it is decreased here, stepwise decrease, intermittent, different pattern, different periods of ultrafiltration and no ultrafiltration. And this was shown in that linear pattern has the least incidence of hypertension and less symptoms as compared to intermittent or step down patterns. Then this song, he compared this 8 different protocols controls, no sodium profiling, no water retention profiling, then step down sodium profiling only when the mean sodium was kept about 143 milliequivalent, then step down where the mean sodium was kept 138 milliequivalent, and the intermittent profiling, sodium profiling only. Share ultra filtration only, then combine sodium profiling and ultra filtration with the high mean dilute sodium, then combine sodium and ultra filtration profiling with the normal sodium level 138 milliequivalent, and then combine the sodium and ultra filtration intermittent profiling here. And they showed this combined sodium and ultra filtration profiling, they are better in causing the or improving the hypotension incidence here as compared to sodium alone or ultra filtration alone. So we also showed the same thing that sodium and UF profiling combined, we have lower incidence of hypotension as compared to UF alone or sodium alone. In this very sense, showed that combined sodium and UF profiling, the blood pressure was maintained at a higher level as compared to sodium or ultra filtration alone or the controls. High dilute sodium. High dilute sodium leading to higher plasma polarity, and that mobilizes the intracellular fluid into the extracellular space, and the removal of fluid from both IC and extracellular fluid, fewer episodes of IDH, better dialysis compliance. But that also results in higher plasma polarity, increased intradialytic weight gain, and hypertension. So this is recommended that you should not use higher dialysis sodium dialysis. Isolated ultrafiltration with removal of isoosmotic water with increase in osmotic pressure in the blood, that is the movement of water from the intracellular compartment to the extracellular compartment. That will decrease the incidence of hypotension. So you can use it isolated ultrafiltration or suspension dialysis, that ultrafiltration with no dialysis followed by dialysis with no water. Biofat feedback systems, blood volume tracking system, blood pressure control system, blood temperature control system, but these are the limitations that still require an input regarding the ultrafiltration volume, the relative blood volume limit, or the desired target volume reduction. And they remember again. Blood volume feedback by the Fresenius company here, real-time monitoring of blood volume here by the use of ultrasonic probe, which measures the metabolic and protein level. And there is a desired blood volume, the metabolism machine, and then this is controller, which tries to keep the blood volume controlled close to the desired blood volume by adjusting the dialysis conductivity or the ultrafiltration rate. The hemocontrol system, they have the measurement of the actual UF, actual sodium, actual blood volume, and then the target ultrafiltration or target sodium or target blood volume are set up in the machine, and then there is a real-time modification of the setting UF rate or dilute sodium is changed by the machine itself, keeping the ultrafiltration volume of the close to the target. The physiologic feedback system, this machine in itself, set up that the target blood volume, one blood pressure being set up by the operator, the machine itself devises the ideal or desired volume curve here, and then monitoring the ultrafiltration rate and actual PVM, adjust the conductivity at ultrafiltration rate to change. Keep the relative blood volume in close to the ideal. body monitoring assumes that the red cell mass or plasma protein density remains constant for the length of the session, which may not be true if there's a modulus of blood leak. Hypertension may not be predicted when the blood volume, blood pressure decreases due to decreasing cardiac output or decreasing peripheral vascular resistance. And then there is a need for feeding the setting of the particular direct blood volume change by the operator. The steps to improve the peripheral vascular resistance need to avoid needs immediately as before dialysis, use the bicarbonate dialysis, dosing and dosing of the antiperspirant medication. It is important that you don't give the medicine before the start of the dialysis. Dialysate composition, dialysate calcium more than 2.25, magnesium more than 1, and full dialysis is the important one. Here is the effect of meals on the splenting circulation. Probably about 30 ml per 100 grams per 100 grams of the tissue, and after meals it goes up to 250 ml per 100 grams. So that's why almost said splenting circulation that we have more blood there instead of being returned to the blood. So you need to avoid the meals during dialysis, bicarbonate dialysis, cure the incidence of intradialytic hypotension as compared to acetate. Timing of the pressure medicine during dialysis. There was a recent study that showed that there was no difference between the two groups who took the medicine before. The other group who did not take the medicine should not be with them before the dialysis. And once this study is undergoing, started in 2018, results hopefully will be out in December 2019, whether we stop the medicine or not. Low dialysate temperature is an important maneuver. The temperature, dialysate temperature 35 to 36, two different methods, empiric fixed reduction or isothermic dialysis technique in which the whole body temperature remains constant while the use of biofeedback temperature control devices. And there are number two large meta-analysis. One was in 2006 and the other one was 2016. Comprising 22 and 28 studies all showed that favorable that it helps to reduce the intradialytic hypotension. Pharmacological interventions, mitotine has been used, ergotamine, sertraline, gefamine, internalizer DDDT, doxidopa. And until recently, the effect of marginal outcome in patients with intradialytic hypotension, and they showed there was a more ischemic injury here. More hospitalization, more cardiac hospitalization when the marginal was used. So that has to be used very carefully. So, dialysis-related hypotension is a common problem occurs in limb dialysis, and palpitation rate and cardiovascular neuroinvolved compulsive responses are inadequate and plasma three-phase is adequate. There can be significant intermittent variability in response to using the same treatment approach is important. Just like one size does not fit all, a personalized approach is needed for application. You can't use the same treatment for everyone. More attention to be focused on reducing the ultrapitation diet by controlling the intradialytic weight gain by protein restriction, avoiding the meals during dialysis or just before dialysis, using low dialysate temperature and then using sodium and ultrapitation profiling. The technology has much to offer but has not solved the persistent problem. Then the team care. Nurse, but those prolonging in high density patients, pharmacists to reduce the time in dwelling of candy absence of medication, reduction to drug therapy and non-lethal drug-related side effects, dietitian from the sodium system diet and food system, and specialists obviously follow this for the correct assessment of the diet and the cardiologist for optimizing the cardiac function, that indicating that ischemic heart disease, heart failure, cardiac disease.